Alright guys, welcome. Let's do this Cambridge International paper 410580, May-June 2017. An energy company charged these prices in 2013. I don't care about the rest, but the electricity price is this much cents per day plus this much for a unit. That's the electricity price. Actually, maybe I didn't need to know that. This is the gas price, 24 cents for a day. Plus 5.5 for each unit. Okay. In 90 days, the screw the family used 1 AA5 units of electricity. Calculate the total cost in dollars of the electricity they used. So the total cost. So we know that is for 90 days, this much units. So we have to do 23.15. Yep, this is for 90 days. And this plus 1885 units, and it is for that the 13.5 cents. That's how much it costs, and that will equal to the answer, which is 2, on my calculator I get 275.31 dollars. Yes. Alright, in 90 days the gas used by the Khan fam, find a nice family is this much. Calculate number of gas units used. So we know it's this is how you get the gas price, and they say the gas price is this much. So it's equal to 198.16, and I need to clarify something. Its total cost was in dollars. They give us cents here and cents. So what you have to do is convert them into dollars. So we have 24.5 divided by 100. This makes it dollars in brackets times 90 days plus, because they even say it here, plus 5.5 cents. 5.5 divided by 100 of x, because we don't know how many they used, so times x. So x is equal to 198.16 subtract 90. Well, it's mental arithmetic is 90 times 0.245 and 0.245, and all of this divided by 0.005. That was x equals to, therefore x is equal to, and if I do it, 3202 units. In 2013, the price of each unit of electricity was this much. Over the next 3 years, the price increased exponentially. Anytime you hear exponentially, alright. Anytime you hear also this exponential thing, it means to the power at a rate of 8%. Calculate the price for each unit of electricity after 3 years. So this was it in the first year. It's like electricity is getting added to itself, so it's a compound interest, and the compound interest we know is the amount into 1 plus, because it's increasing. It said the price of for each unit of electricity was this. Well, the price increased exponentially at a rate of 8%. So 1 plus 8%, which is 8 by 100, hold to the power 3, because we're on it for 3 years. And that is equal to, in my calculator, I've write that down, I get, and I'm running off, I get 17.0, but it's just the same, 17.0 to 3 significant figures. Over these 3 years, the price for each unit of gas increased from this much to this much. Alright. Calculate the percentage increase from 5.5 cents to 7.7 cents. Alright, so we know that it was 5.5 cents. This 5.5 cents got multiplied with a certain percentage. And that percentage, when multiplied with 5.5, is going to give us this new 7.7. So if I do that, x is equal to 7.7 divided by 5.5, which is 1.4. But this is x percent. Remember x percent. So that's basically x by 100. I should have just put it down by 100. So if x by 100 equals 1.4, then x is equal to 140. However, they didn't say calculate that. They said calculate the percentage increase. How much did the percentage increase by? So you have 100%. Anything above is the percentage increase. Anything below is a decrease. So 140 minus 100 is equal to 40. So that's how much percent it increased by. 40%. Alright, next question. Over the 3 years, the 5.5 cents increased exponentially. Okay, here's where we know we can use compound interest. By the same percentage each year to the 7.7 cents, calculate the percentage increase each year. Excellent. So they want the percentage increase each year. So in order to do this one, we know that it was 5.5%, and this increased exponentially by the same percentage. So the same percent. So if I do this, is 1 plus x by 100 for 3 years. And that gives me 7.7. So if I rearrange and do algebra, I get 100 plus x by 100 is equal to 7.7 by 5.5. Then I get 100. Actually, let me check if 1 plus x upon 100 gives me 1. So this common denominator is 1, common denominator is 1. So if the common denominator is 1, then 100, I made a tiny mistake here. It's 100 plus x, everything divided by 100, because I did this here. And so now I'm going to get 100. So after I do this part, I'm going to get 100 plus x, 100 plus x, and that's going to equal to 140. And hold on, actually, I can't believe myself nowadays. This is cube. Yeah, this is cube. And I should have just put it here in brackets so it doesn't confuse you. This is cube. Let me put here. This is 100 plus x by 100 whole cube equal to 7.7. So, yeah. And this part here is not correct. So, we get 100 plus x by 100. And now it's whole cube. So, I'm taking the cube root now. The cube root of 7.7 by 5.5. And then, if I rearrange, do all the algebra, my x is going to equal to 11.9, after being rounded off, of course, 11.9. In 2015, you know, I don't even have to read this thing because I've done so many examples of it. Let me just know its profit was this much, okay? Calculate the amount the company gave to the shareholders, okay? 5 was the shareholders, share. So 5 by 5 plus 2 plus 6 multiplied by 390. I don't even have to look at questions like this. 5 by 5 plus 2 plus 6 multiplied by 390, and I get 150 million. 150 million. 150. All right, let's get out of here. The share price of the company in June was this much. So June was 258.25. This price was an increase of 3.3% on the share price in May 2015. Calculate the share price in May 2015. Okay, so this one was an increase. So I shouldn't have just written this one down. So let me just understand. So this was an increase of 3.3%. So equal to 258.25. So it was an increase. They say it was an increase of 3.3%. Yeah. So we need to calculate the share price in May, June 2015. In May 2015. Sometimes, you know. Okay, so to do that, I first write down my X. This is gonna be the share price in 2015. This one gets multiplied by an increase of 3.3%. So that's, it's not multiplied by 3.3, it's multiplied with by an increase of 3.3. So that's 100 plus 3.3, and it's a percentage, so divided by 100. So if I do my algebra and stuff, I'm gonna get X is equal to 258.25 by 100 plus 3.3 by 100, and then 258.25 by the answer, and then X is gonna equal to 250. Yep. Boom. That was easy enough, right? An increase, that's why we said 100 plus 3.3, and it's a percentage, so everything divided by 100, and the money times the percentage gives us the new money. Alright, let's go. Find the modal class. The modal class, the one that repeats the most, so it's 24, this one here. 71 is less than equal to t is less than equal to 72. Calculate an estimate of the mean. So for 4 marks, sigma fx by sigma f. Now I know an awesome way to do this without even having to use your calculator for lots of it. So yeah, for this, according to this, we have to find the mid value times it by the frequency, mid value times it for the frequency, mid times frequency for everything. Yeah, so if you add these two and divide by two, it's just going to be this number plus 0.5, the upper bound of it. So that's 70.5 times its frequency, which is 17. And then we add it to 71.5, the mid value, times 24. 71.5, yeah. And then we add that to 72.5 times 21 plus 73. See, I'm so good, I'm not even using calculator to do this part, times 18. Oh man, come on, I need space. Plus, plus 74.5. Can I squeeze it in? Almost, I think I can. It's 74.5 multiplied by what? By 10. Yep. And all of this is, of course, divided by the sum of the frequencies, which is 90, because this 90 students is just, if you add all these frequencies, it's just the 90 cars, sorry, not students. And if I do that, I'm gonna get a value of 72 after being rounded, of course, 72 to three significant figures, 72.3. So if you add two even numbers and divide by two, that's obviously the mid value, and you can divide it by two, it's easy. But if you add an even an odd and divide by 2, it's just basically the odd number, or whatever the lowest number is, in this case is this one, and the upper bound of it. So 70 plus 0.5, 71 plus 0.5. Yep, that's a fast method, and you don't have to waste time on this easy mark part. Alright, let's go. Who cares? Just calculates cumulative frequency. Cumulative frequency is just adding on frequencies. So 17 plus 24 is 41. Yeah, guys. And then 41 plus 21 is 62. 62 plus 18 is 70. Shit, I don't know, man. 70. 62 plus 18 is 80. And 80 plus 10 is 90. And since this 90 is the same as the adding of the frequency, which 90, which is the same as this, is correct. Alright, whatever, find the median. The median is obviously half of 90, which is here. And if I go down, for me, I'm gonna get 72.15. And obviously, you have to plot the graph. So you just get your seconds, this, against that. So you have seconds here, and you have cumulative there. And then you would start from zero and go all the way. We just assume it starts from zero. Even if it doesn't here, we just assume and then connect it. Find the interquartile range. Interquartile range is 3/4 of 90, which is this, and this value minus 1/4 of 90. So it's the upper quartile, 3/4 of 90, minus the lower quartile, 1/4 of 90, but not this minus this. This is going to give you the mid value, but we want the interquartile range, which is this value minus this. And according to me, if I do it, I'm gonna get 1.9. Yep, one lap of the racetrack measures this much. So is it similar to the last question? Yeah, but we don't really need it. I think one lap of the racetrack measures this much distance, correct to the nearest 10 meters. Okay, 75 seconds, correct to the nearest second. Calculate the upper bound of the average speed of this car. Give your answer in kilometer per hour. This is awesome. And another important thing is the upper bound for the average speed. So we know first, let's just write the speed formula. Speed is equal to distance divided by time. So in order to get the highest value, distance needs to be the greatest and the time needs to be the shortest, the smallest. So upper bound here, lower bound here. So let's find the lower bound of the time. The lower bound of the time for 75 seconds to the nearest second. So that is so we have unit 10, so this is the second, the nearest unit, but then we need the lower bound of that, so that's 74.5. so if I round this off, it gives me 74 or it gives me 75. That's why it's the lower bound. And then we have to calculate the upper bound of the distance, 3720, which is 3725 to the nearest 10. Sorry, to nearest 10. So I actually messed that up. So I think, no, I didn't think I did. So units tens, the tens depends on the value on the right of the 10, which is the units. In order, so the upper bound would be 3, 7, 2, but this value depends on this. So we add 5. So that's 3725. Now, this number, if we round off, gives us 37220, or it gives us 3730 to the nearest tens if we round it off. That's why it is the highest possible value that can round off to this. Now, one more thing, this was meter per second and this is kilometer per hour. So we have to realize something. First, let's just do the distance time formula. So the distance is 3725 divided by the time, 74.5, which is if I do it, 3725 by 74.5, and I'm gonna get 50. Right, 74.5. Let me see. Correct. So this is meter per second. The best way to meter per second is higher than kilometer per hour. So you multiply it by 18 by 5, which is 3.6. And if you want to convert kilometer per hour, you do the kilometer per hour times 5 by 18 to get meter per second. So if we multiply our answer by 18 by 5, which is 3.6, we get 180, my friends. Yep. And obviously, you see how much we did. Not that much, but we did enough. We got our 4 marks. Okay. Draw the image of triangle C after the reflection in x equals 4. X equals 4 is here. X equals 4. Now, I don't usually, in the examination, if you don't want to lose any marks, then you should do it good, like really good. But for me, I'm doing it fast. So this is 1, 2 here. So 1, that means I'm going to go 1 again. 1, this is my points here. And then it is 2 points away, so dot dot. So this is my second point, which is 1, 2, 3 above, so 1, 2, 3, and on the top here. So I have it here and here, sorry, here. And now I can just join my triangle. Do I have to label it? No. Draw the image of triangle A after a rotation of 90 degrees anti-clockwise about 0, 0. Excellent. So anti-clockwise about 0, 0, if we use the base vector method, if here's our 1, 0, 0, 1, if we make it go that way, that's going to become 0, 1. If this goes that way, if it goes anti-clockwise, that's going to become negative 1, 0. That's how we got the anti-clockwise matrix. Now this anti-clockwise matrix, 0, negative 1, 1, 0. If you multiply by all the points in our triangle, which is 1, 1, 1, 3, 1, 3, dang, not 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 4, and what's the last one? 3, 1. If we multiply it, we're gonna get the matrix negative 1, 1, yep, negative 4, 1, and one more, negative 1, 3. So you can see that if it goes back, and let me plot that, negative 1, 1, negative 4, 1, negative 3, yep. And it was a anti-clockwise rotation. And you can see that the points, the x, y coordinates swapped and they became negative. It's just something interesting to see. But yeah, that's the identity matrix for anti-clockwise, and you multiply by the points, you get this. So fast, so easy. The tracer paper thing is just a waste of time. Trust me, describe fully single matrix that maps triangle A. Sorry, I skipped a question. Draw the image of triangle A after the translation by the vector 1, negative 5. It always goes in the x, y direction. So it goes in the x direction by 1. So this point goes by 1. Then it goes down by negative 5. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yep. So it ends up here, and then I know this is 2 back, so 1, 2 gets here, and then it's 3 up, 1, 2, 3, so here. That's my triangle. Boom. So fast, yeah, you're like, you wish you had someone like me, guys. You wish you had someone like me. Alright, I've done that. Describe fully the single transformation that maps triangle A onto triangle B. Where's the bloody, oh, it's here, the triangle. So it looks like, what is it? It looks like, remember what I told you? For don't matter about the shape. If the shape size changes, no matter what, it looks like a rotation, but no matter what, if the size of the shape changes, no matter what you think it is always enlargements. So it is enlargements, enlargements. And for enlargements, we have to find the scale factor, comma, just find the normal scale factor. So 1, 2, 3, and we have, hold on, we have 2 here, but then we have 1 here. So for A, this has to go half of its size here to get there. So the scale factor is a half, but not just any regular half. It's called a negative half, because if you can see negative, it's flipped. This is now here. I mean, it's flipped. So this is down now, and it's down here. So its enlargement negative a half is a scale factor. And now we just have to determine the most troublesome thing, the center of rotation. So these two join. Now if I keep extending, dang, I need my lines to be good. That looks wrong again. That looks more wrong. I will just do it manually. Join those two lines, and then I just keep extending it backwards. Yep. And then, nigga, get lost. Then I have this point, which corresponds with this point. Sorry, let me get rid of these ugly ass marks here. I have this point that corresponds with this point, and this point with this point. So I'm just going to join this and this, keep extending it, and keep extending until it goes. Yep. Then I'm going to do, we already have it intersecting at a point, but I'm just going to make sure it's that point. We have this going all the way here. That's also a really bad, actually guys, this is a problem if you don't use ruler. Use your ruler. So for me, it looks like this line and this line was drawn nicely. So that looks like 5.5. Yep, 5.5. And that's it, 5.5, because the two lines that I drew two nice lines. That's why it intersected nicely at 5.5. But this jagged line here is like, you can, if you make it more straight, it's gonna intersect here. All right, let's go find the matrix that represents part AII. Shit, I just showed you guys how to find it here, and you have to find it. So let's just, this is what you do. You just do 1 0 0 1, and that, and then, you know, you just do the cardinal stuff. If you do this, those examiners know your shit in math. So this is 1 0, this is 0 1. They know that you know. So this goes anti-clockwise, so that this point becomes 0 1. If this goes anti-clockwise, let me draw it a bit more nicely. If this goes anti-clockwise, it's going to become -1 0, and that's always x, y. So the transformation is 0 -1 1 0. Boom. Now let's keep going. Alright, I don't care. P has this coordinate. Find G of P. Alright, 2 marks. G is 1 0 0 2. Multiply by P. X, Y. This is a coordinate XY. This is XY, XY. That gets multiplied by XY. Yep, and that is equal to, if you do the multiplication nicely, you're going to get, I have to do this in my calculator as well. You're going to get 4, 2. And that's your point. X is 4, Y is 2. Find GF of P. So it's a combination. So you first do F times P, then you do G times of that, because with matrices, the order always matters. Alright, so that's times of F, -1 0 0 1. And that, so this one first, the F first gets multiplied by P, which is 4 1. Yeah, so, and this is equal to, let me first rub this out here. We're first going to do this part. This is equal to row times column, so 1, -4, -4, 1. Yep, -4, 1. Now, this -4, 1 then gets multiplied, -4, 1. gets multiplied by G, which is 1002. I don't like how the IG guys, they took out the shear and stretch, but this is in the form K100K, and this represents the Y. So if you multiply this easy, this what, this thing stays the same, but it's just this that changes, and this is 2 times 1, the Y that changes. And because it's a stretch, which is not in the syllabus, but they sneaked it in, but it, you don't really need to know a stretch to do this. So if you have 100K, this is 1, so it always stays the same, 1 times, that's always the same. But then the K is for the, determines the Y, so K is 2, 2 times 1 is 2. But that's not the method for matrix, it's row times column. But a fast way to do it, if you knew stretch or shear, was 1 times X, which is this, and 2 times this, which is that. And if you have the 0, 1, it's 1 times negative 4 plus 0 times that. So it's just 1 times that, that, 0 times that, plus 2 times that. So you can see, you can just skip it and do that, that, 2 times that, that. Alright, negative 4, 2. Hey, should I waste so much time explaining to you guys? Alright, this is a nice question. So we have to find Q. Alright, so to find Q, first we pre-multiply, you can do it anyway, I don't give a shit, you pre-multiply, that means here's the pre-multiple, you pre-multiply by its inverse, so G inverse times Q, P is equal to, and since you pre-multiply, this side is also gonna get pre-multiplied, G inverse P. Remember I told you how the matrix operation matters? You can't have G inverse P is not the same as P G inverse. The multiplication matters. So you pre-multiply here. So a matrix times its inverse is always the identity matrix I, Q. Then we post-multiply after. So after Q is P, so P. Then we post-multiply, so we multiply by P inverse on the right. So this is a post-multiple, and that's going to equal to G inverse P, P inverse. Yep, guys. And then that means this is IQI, which is equal to G inverse by itself, and P times P inverse, because we have to do these two first. Not these two, it's like first this one gets multiplied by that, then that. So P times P inverse is I, is the identity matrix. Identity matrix is 1001. Identity matrix times anything is always itself. So here Q times I is Q, and then times I again is still Q. So G inverse is AD minus BC, which is, well, 80, which is 2, so 1 by 2, 1 by 80 minus BC of, then we swapped elements, 2, 1, 0, 0, so this is it, this is what it is, 2, 0, 0, 1, a half. So I don't, most of you won't know how to do this, because I don't think most of you have learned pre-multiplying, then post-multiply. You can even pre-multiply and post-multiply simultaneously, and then you just get IQI equals G inverse PP inverse. But PP inverse, because you have to always multiply the furthest one on the right with the one on the left, which is P times P inverse, which is I, then G inverse times I is itself. Alright, the graph shows Y is equal to F of X for this point from here to here. Alright, don't mind this, I'll come to it soon. Find f of 1. So y is equal to f of x. Now we have plugged in the x value of 1. So at the x value of 1, they want us to find the y coordinates. Because we plugged in the x value, they want us to find the y coordinates. So for this, when I draw the straight line, it goes exactly in half of 2, 4, and 6. So I'm getting vibes of negative 1.5. Yep, I'm getting negative 1.5. Because if you want a better example, y is equal to f of y is equal to f of x. So y is equal to f of 1. We replace x with 1. So what is the y value? Because that's what it means to find f of 1, the y value. So we did it. Solve f of x is equal to 3. So f of x is equal to y as well. So now y is equal to 3. So if y is equal to 3, what is the x coordinate? If y is equal to 3, well, we draw it here. And it gets down exactly in half. You can even see it. So that is negative 0.5. Yes. The equation f of x equal to a number has only one solution. K is a number for the graph negative 2.5 for that interval. Write down the range of k values for which this is the range. So the one range where it has only one solution. So we know two solutions. So it is above negative 4 that no matter how many, if we keep drawing the line, we're going to get only one solution. So k should be greater than negative, not equal to, because just greater than, because you see at this point it's crossing here. So greater than negative 4, it only cuts this graph, this part of the graph, and it only gets you one solution for x. Now let's go by drawing a suitable line, f of x equals x minus 5, so y is equal to x minus 5. Find the values. Alright, suitable line. So I drew that line here, y is equal to x minus 5, or f of x is equal to x minus 5, and it cuts here, here, and here. And for me, if I do that, this is negative 2, here it's negative 2, so I go 1, and it's like 1 again, but it's here, so it is negative 2 point, I think it's 0.1, so negative 2 point is a negative 1.5, and that would make sense if that gives me negative 2. So negative 2.1, negative 2.2, and mine looks like it cuts at negative 2.2. So I'm gonna go and write that down. Negative, not highlights, negative 2.2. And the other ones that I get for my graph is negative 1.2 and 1.3. Yep. But don't worry, your value should be, if it's negative 2.3, until negative 2.3, then you're alright. And this one is negative 1.2 until negative 1.1, you're good. Positive 1.3 to positive 1.4, you're good. Draw attention to the graph y is equal to f of x. So draw attention to your graph where x is equal to 1. Use a tangent to estimate the gradient of the graph when x is equal to 1. So here is when x is equal to 1, yeah, and they draw a gradient. I just made my gradient small because of convenience, but you can make your gradient big. So if with my gradient, but don't make it too huge, then you're not gonna get a freaking proper answer. So with mine, we can take this as y2, y1, and the y2 value, the y value is negative 2, negative 2.4, and the x value is 1.2. So we have negative y2 minus y1, negative 2 minus, I don't know what the y1 is, but on the x2, which I have is 1.2 minus x1. So I think I can take this point here, yeah, this point here, because it intersects at x is 1 and y is negative 1.4, right? Negative 1.4. So I can put it here in my graph, negative 1.4. So minus negative 1.4, it becomes a plus, don't worry. And what that subtracts by 1. And if I put it into my calculator, I'm gonna get negative 2, negative, negative 1.4 by 1.2 minus 1, and I'm gonna get an answer of negative 3. very good, and that is my gradients. You can get, also for this question, you can get an answer from negative 6 to negative 4. Alright, cylinder shows, whatever, diagram shows cylinder radius, this, don't care about the rest. Calculate the volume, show it's this. The volume for the cylinder is always pi times the r squared, which is 18 squared, times the height, pi r squared h, which is 50. And my volume, how many marks is this thing? My volume is going to equal to 18 squared times pi times 50, which is 50893. I don't care about the rest. And show that it rounds off to this according to 3SF. So 1, 2, that's a significant figure, depends on the fourth significant figure, but this is greater than 5, so this is 50900, which is equal to 50900, which is the same as this one. Now let's keep going. I don't care, 30 liters of coffee, are poured into the container. Work out the height of the empty space, not this, the empty space. So we know that 30 liters is the volume, so 30 liters, and you know, here we calculated the volume in centimeter cube, but 30 liters is higher than centimeter cube, so you multiply by 100 cubic centimeter, 10 times 10 times 10, which is 1,000. So this is the volume in centimeter cube, is equal to the radius, which is the same radius, which is 18 squared times pi times the h height. And then if I do with my lovely algebra to get the height times pi, I'm gonna get 29.47 to four significant figure, but that's the height for this thing. May I want this empty space height? I know the total height is 50, so I'm gonna say 50 subtract 29.47, and then I'm gonna get 50 minus the answer according to three significant figures, this 20.5. boom, easy as, let's go. The cup, I don't care, this is the radius. Work out the maximum cups. This can be completely filled from the 30 liters coffee in the container. Now it's not like you find the highest numerator and divide by the smallest denominator. It's more like, because they just said find the maximum number of cups, they didn't mention anything about the upper and lower bounds, so you should not consider using any upper or lower bound at all. Okay guys, so let's do this. So what do these assholes want? Fill the from this to this, or a maximum number of cups. So to do this, we know the volume of the coffee, and we know this is a hemisphere. So the hemisphere's volume is actually a half of the 4 by 3 pi r squared h. So we know the pi, which is 3. We know it's pi. Pi is pi times the r cubed. So 3.5 whole cubed. And that's going to equal the volume of the cup. Volume of the cup. So now the volume of the cup, V of C, is equal to, and if I do that in my calculator, a half times 4 over 3 times pi times 3.5 whole cube is gonna equal to 89.797. And let me hope I did not do anything wrong here. Centimeter, alright, 30 liters. So we calculate centimeter cube. So in order to get this, we have to do the volume of the coffee. Shit, coffee, why does it have to be so hard? The coffee is limited, CO, for volume of coffee by the volume of the cup. That gives us the maximum number of cups we can use. Logically anyway, if I have 10 sweets and we have to give it to a child and like to children, no, not to children, if I have 10 sweets and I have to give them to 5 children equally, I have to divide it by 2. Yeah, so I hope you understood that. Now let's do this I hope you can relate to it as well. So 30 liters times 1,000, or 10 times 10 centimeter squared times 10 centimeter cube. Now we have volume, so that's 30 liters, which we is this, and we calculate this in centimeter cube. So, and now I'm going to divide by the volume, which is 89.797, and that is equal to 30 times 10 times 10 times 10 by the answer, and I'm gonna get 334. Even round off the three significant figures is this. Boom, easy, right? It was not hard. I don't care. Calculate. Well, hold on. I care about this one. Capacity of each glass 95 cubic centimeter. Calculate the radius. Show that it rounds off to 2.3. Now they want us to use volume, of course. So the volume of a cone, which is this good, it's actually half cone or something, is volume is 95 is equal to 1/3. Mention the question that it was 95, guys, here, into pi into r squared, times r squared times the height. R is equal to, how many marks is this? Three marks. Are r is equal to the root of 95 divided by, the height is 8.4. From here all the way to here, they say it's 8.4. Yep. And that would be 8.4 times pi times 1/3. And that is equal to the root of, let me just put in my calculator, 95 by 8.4 times pi times 1 divided by 3. And if I do that in my calculator and I round it off to three significant figures, I get 3.28. Okay, I don't care, air equals pi r l. You want the area, yeah? And you need pi r l, the slant height, which is this line here. So this height is the same, 8.4. We know the radius, 3.28, which I'm gonna put as 3.3. Because it's just because it's 8.4, one significant, that's why, just be safe. So 8.4 whole squared plus 3.3 whole squared is equal to c squared. So c is equal to, according to that son of a bitch Pythagoras, is the root of, let me do it in my calculator, 8.4 is the root of, 8.4 whole squared plus 3.3 whole squared, 8.4 squared plus 3.3 squared, 3.3 squared is this. Root the answer, c is equal to 9.025. Now I know the slant height, a is equal to pi times 3.3 times 9.025. A is equal to 9.025 times 3.3 times the pi. I like pi. Pi makes me greedy all the time. 93.56, which is going to equal to 93.6 as my final answer. Lovely question. Let's go. Alright guys, we're back. So this is easy. I'm not doing it. This one I might do. It looks more interesting. Anyway, 3x squared is equal to 75. Before we even bring that 75 there, try doing your nonsense factorizing. You need to realize that there's a simple way to do it. Look for that simple way. X is equal to the plus or minus. Always, guys, when you take the square root, it's the plus or minus. So X is equal to plus or minus 5. So the X value can be 5 or negative 5. That's why never, there's always an easy way to do it. If there's no, it's not the X plus AX squared plus BX plus C. So find the easy method. Let's go. find the coordinates of the midpoint AB, so they're on the same line. So if you want to find the midpoint, you have to add the x coordinates, add the y coordinates, and divide by 2. So negative 3 plus 2 upon 2 comma 8 plus of negative 2 plus of negative 2 upon 2, and according to my calculator, I'm gonna get those points as negative 1/2 and 3. Done. A line through AB in the y equals mx plus c. M is equal to, you know, y2 minus y1, negative 2 minus 8, upon x2, 2 minus or minus 3, and that's going to give me a gradient of negative 2. In the substitution method, like, I'm going to substitute yx in my equation y is equal to mx plus c. This is why my gradient is this of 2 plus c, and if I rearrange with algebra, c is gonna equal to positive 2. So y is equal to negative 2 of x plus 2. So a line that's parallel lines are just so in this case the gradient is negative, so it's going downwards. Parallel lines just have the same gradient, the same steepness. See, it's going down the same steepness. And then, yeah, that's all this. They have the same gradient. So this is passing through y is equal to 7, 2 of 0, negative 2 times of 0, which is plus c. So c is equal to 7. And then we have in the form y is equal to negative 2x plus c, which is 7. Alright, this is a nice question here. Passes through 1/5, ax plus by plus c. A nice thing to note with this form is that if this a is a fraction, it can never be a fraction. The ax, the a should never be a fraction. Yep, it could be negative, but it should never be a fraction. That's the rule. So we only have a point. We can't use mx plus c, but we could. But I don't want to use mx plus c. It's hard if you use mx plus c. Remember, we have two ways. First, let's find the gradient. m1 into m2 is equal to negative 1. We know that they're perpendicular, the line perpendicular. So m2 is going to equal to negative. This m1 was 2. So m2 is negative 2. So the new gradient is 1/2. So now that we know the gradient, we remember this formula, y minus y1 is equal to m of x minus x1. Don't worry, there's no plus c. This is the point the point intercept form. The line slope form is this one. So yeah, remember this. You automatically get your c. If you were to work it out. So this way, and y is equal to mx plus c is two ways of finding the line, the equation of the lines. This y minus y1 is equal to m, which is 1/2 of times the x, which is x, minus the x1, which is 1. So negative 1/2 of it's 1/2 times negative 1, which is negative 1/2. So if I do that, I'm going to get y is equal to 1/2 of x. And surprisingly, they wanted to see if students remembered this ax plus by plus c, that a should not be a fraction. 1/2 x. And then if I do, it's going to be negative 1/2 plus 5, which is 9 upon 2. 9 upon 2 is it? Negative 0.5 plus 5. Yeah. Plus 5. Yeah, 9 upon 2. Yep. And it's plus positive 9 upon 2. Now, if we say 0 is equal to 1/2 x plus 9 by 2, well, in the form by, so negative y plus 9 by 2, we know that we can write the 9 by 2. 9 by 2. But, no, sorry, we shouldn't write the 9 by 2 just like that. Sorry, you would have made a mistake not getting the marks. So, we say that this a, the a, should not be a fraction. So we multiply this entire equation on the left and right by half to get rid of this half, by 2 to get rid of the half. So 2 times a half is 1. So 1x, 0. So let's write the final equation. 0 is equal to x minus 2y plus of 9. So we have it ax, 1x, my plus by, in this case, minus 2, plus c. Yeah. And yeah, that was it. You need to remember both. I was kind of waiting for these guys to ask us for a question like this, because they never asked us for stuff which is in the form ax plus by plus c in a long time. Okay, I don't care much about this. Find the bearing of a from b. So that bearing is from here all the way until this point here. That's the bearing. So until here is the bearing. So we can find this and subtract from 360. 360 minus, and we know this angle b, 360 minus of, we know that this angle is 180. Since this line is parallel to this line, this is 180 minus that. So 180 minus 110 is 70. So 360 minus 70, and that is 360 minus answer 290, and that's the bearing. 290. Calculate angle BAC. What the hell? 5 marks. BA, so they want this angle. Cosine. Can I use cosine rule? Not exactly. So how do I find that angle? So let me just put it. So we need to find this angle. I have a side. Need this side to use cosine rule. Maybe I can find that side somehow. Well, maybe since it's hard to find this angle here, because we need to find this, it would be a harder process. There's no way we can find that angle right now, but we do know that this angle is 70. We know that the total of this entire angle is 360, so we can say 360 minus 70 plus 280. Yeah, and if I do 360 minus 70 plus 280, I'm gonna get 10 degrees. So this here is 10 degrees. And now that I have this 10 degrees, I'm just gonna use, can I find this length? Sine this by this is equal to, no, I can't, sadly. I can't, so we're gonna use sine rule and go all the way. So let's do this. Sine, oh, we want the angle, so sine 10 upon this 38, sine 10 upon 38 is equal to sine of c. Let's call it sine of c, because we know we don't know c's angle, but we know its side, but we don't know a's angle in this side, so we just use the sine of c upon 50. And then sine c is equal to sine 10 by 50. 38, and we're gonna multiply that by 50. Yeah, sine c, guys. So c is equal to sine, I'm gonna be a smartass here, the arc sine, which is basically sine inverse, but on the calculator you put it as sine inverse, but arc sine just means the sine inverse. So the sine inverse of sine 1 of 10 degrees by 38 multiplied by 50 would be 13.2 degrees, rounded off nicely. So sorry, damn it. So the sine of what am I gonna put in? The sine of 0.228482848. So the sine inverse of that is 13.2. Nicely. So that's the sine of that. Now we know that this angle is 13. Yeah, the angle we found it 13.2, and we know all the angles add up to 180. So 180 minus of 13.2 plus of 10 degrees, and that's gonna give me 180 minus 13.2 plus 10. Usually don't round off the answers until the end, but then if it's so obvious that you don't really need to round off to get the actual answer, then you don't really need to. So it could be 156.8. In this case, you really don't round it off to three significant figures. Just in angles, IGCSE never really marks you down for putting four significant figures. So I would just leave it like our answer, 156.8. And I'll write that nice angle down. 156.8. You remember, you might get penalized for writing in three significant figures for the angle, but you can leave it in four. They have always accepted that a road is built from A to join to straight road BC. To join the straight road BC, and a road is built from A. So it's built from A to. So basically, a road was built from A to join the road BC. Calculate the shortest possible length of this new road. Shortest possible length. So basically, okay, this is a lovely question. They said that a road is built from A, so from A to join the straight line BC. So we know that BC is a straight line. So this is A here. Let me do in this red. So when they say calculate the shortest distance, I wish the teachers taught this more often. The shortest distance is always the perpendicular distance. So imagine that A to the line BC was actually 90 degrees. Yeah? Imagine that it was 90 degrees. So if it was 90 degrees, then calculate the shortest possible length. So it would be like this. We have C that goes to an angle and meets at A, but then this is 90 degrees. This is the length X, the road that was built. We know C to A is 38. And then if we keep extending that line, here is B. Yeah. And yes, like this. So it is B. So we just need to find that angle. And we know the angle here, which is, what I calculate as 13.2. So basically the shortest distance, the shortest possible length for this road is, and is always at a right angle, is always the perpendicular distance, which is, in this case, this the perpendicular distance, because it's 90 degrees to this, it's at 90 degrees to this line, so this makes this a perpendicular line, which is the perpendicular distance. So this perpendicular distance is always the shortest, and since perpendicular is 90, so we can use our basic trig functions. Sine of 13.2 is equal to x opposite by hypotenuse. So x is equal to sine 13.2 multiplied by 38. X is equal to, and I if I round off the three significant figures, which you can do here, is 8.6. You can always round off to three significant figures for most questions except the angles. Don't take risk with the angles, just leave it in four. Alright, let's go. Town A has a rectangular park. Rectangle, okay, man, I'm drawing this. It has a rectangular park. So they're just saying that town is, we don't need that question anymore. So town A is a town and it has this rectangular park. It has a length of x. So length of x I think that's the length on a triangle. Length width, I think that's the length. The width of the park is 25 meters shorter than the length. So if the length is x, the width is 25 shorter, so x minus 25. Yep. And then I'm gonna put it here, x minus 25, right guys? And let me make it a bit clear for you to see, x minus 25. The area of the park is this much. Alright, show that x squared. Alright, so, and you also have that area there, so there's an indication. They gave you the area and they said in this form, ax squared plus bx plus c, I think. So, you know, if they give you the length and width and they give you the area of, and they say it's equal to 0, they obviously want you to find area, so that's x minus 25. X minus 25, x minus 25 length times the width, or width times length, it doesn't matter. If you multiply the length and width, that gives us, and how many marks is this? This 1 mark, god damn it. Greedy motherfuckers at Cambridge. Dang. So length times width is equal to the area. And if I do that, I get x squared, minus 25x, bring it to that side, minus 2200 is equal to 0. Damn those son of a bitches at Cambridge, 1 mark, they're greedy like shit. Like, what the hell? They could have given us 2 at least, unfair bastards. Okay, this is, if they always want 2 decimals, they want 2 decimals, alright? And you can't factorize this one out, that's why it's x is equal to that or that, and they say 2 decimals, that means it's gonna have decimals, and you can't factorize with decimals. So is ax squared plus bx plus c is equal to 0? And if we have that, we have the formula to find it, to find the x solutions, is minus b plus or minus root of b squared, so negative 25, which is b squared, minus 4ac, which is times a times c, 220, all divided by 2 times of 1. Yes, you include the symbols. Why did I put in minus b? Minus, it is minus b, so minus of minus 25 is plus 25. Yeah, and let's do that. 25 plus or minus roots of 25 squared minus 4 times negative 220 is, hope I do this right, is, dang, that's huge, 50, 50, 0, 0. Oh, sorry, also important thing, I accidentally forgot to put in this 0, so I'm gonna get a huge number, 55 and 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and that's everything divided by 2. So we have 25 plus, say you have 1 mark, 2 mark, now we're gonna get the 4th mark, or yeah, something like that. We have 25 plus, we have to take the positive root, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 upon 2. And we have to take the negative root, 25 minus root of 5, 1, 5, 5, 5, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, everything divided by 2. That's equal to, if I do it in my calculator right now, 25 plus root of, okay, so my calculator gives me a final answer when beautifully rounded off to two decimals, negative, sorry, I didn't do one of the roots, 25 minus roots of answer upon 2, yeah, let me, 25 minus the roots of negative 25 squared minus 4 times 1 times negative 2200, it gives me negative 36 0.04, and for the positive one gives me 61.04. So I have x is 61.04, any order doesn't matter, 36.04. Yes, and I have a quick doubt though with negative, like when I put in my calculator, I didn't exactly put in that huge 50,000 number. I just put in 4 times 1 times of negative 2212. Oh shit, that's why I was just skeptical. I was like, how could the number be so large and you get that? So if you do this thing inside, you're actually going to get 9425. 9425. And again, one more time, 9425. Alright, be careful with that. Don't overthink. I mean, don't act too smart. Alright. The end term of sequence 8n minus 3. Fire. Write down the first two terms of the sequence. So n is 1. 8 times 1 minus 3. And that is going to give me 5. And then if I substitute 2, 16 minus 3, 13. Show that the number 203 is not in the sequence. So 8n minus 3 is the nth term. But we're supposed to show that 203 is not in the sequence. So n is equal to, how many marks is this? 2 marks. So I'm going to skip lots of steps. 203 plus 3. Answer divided by 8. And we're going to get 25.75. And that's wrong, because you can't have a 25. N cannot equal, N is equal to 25.75, but N cannot equal 25.75 as because you can't have N equal, you have a first term and a second term, you can't have 1.5 term. That's not possible. Your coefficient of N could be a half or something, but you can't have, see, you have the first term, the second term, third term, you can't have 1.5 term. So yeah, that's why N cannot equal, answer equals a fraction. We just put this as in fraction form. N equals, just so we can make it clear, 103 by 4, but N cannot equal fraction. Fraction, which is, it cannot equal to 103 by 4. Done. Solid evidence for 2 marks. Find the nth term of the sequence. 19 minus 13 is 6. 25 minus 19 is 6. 6. So obviously it's plus 6. So 31 plus 6 is 37. Boom, we have written down that. And we have to also find the nth term. So we know it's plus 6. So if it's that, we can use the arithmetic formula. UN is equal to A plus N minus 1 into the difference. The common difference we know is 6, because it's 6. And the first term, A means the first term. So the first term is 13. And if we use our lovely algebra, we're going to get 6N plus 7. So that's it, 6N. Plus 7. They better give us 3 marks. Bastards, damn it. So, this one is it, I think it's, let's just see. 8 minus 4. 8 minus 4 is, 8 minus 4 is 4. 14. 14 minus 8 is 6. And, 22 minus 14 is 8. 22 minus 14 is 8. So we subtract these two again, we're gonna get 2. So how many marks is this one? Also, best is 2, and it's so hard. A is equal to 1, so n squared, so n squared plus 3a, so 3 times 1 B is equal to 3A minus 3A plus 4. B is equal to 1, so plus N. Right now, I should have mentioned this earlier, so I'm really sorry guys. If you want to know how I'm doing all of this, then please, if you want to know how I'm doing this method here, because it's too hard to explain right now, like it's gonna use too much time, just I'm gonna link a video right now, click on it and forward to the end where there's an nth term. I'm gonna mention how to find for quadratic sequences if it goes down twice. Alright guys, this part, the second term of the sequence is 20. Alright, the third term is 50. The rule, here's where it gets interesting. For finding the next term, the term after it, in this sequence is subtract y. So you subtract y, and then you multiply it by 5. And that gives us the next term. So to find the, so let's just, before we even do anything, and before we even look at the marks and get scared, to find the next term, we subtract y and multiply it by 5. So let's say we have this 50 term. The 50th term. This 2 marks, don't want to do this 2 marks, it's easy. This, the 3 dots doesn't mean you put in a number. I just realized right now, it just means it's continuing, it goes on and on. So for finding the next number in the sequence, you subtract y and then multiply by 5. So this was the formula. So there's a reason they gave us 20 and 50. Think about it. To find the next term in the sequence, we have to subtract y, then multiply by 5. So if we have 20, to find the next term, we have to subtract 20 minus y. 20 minus y, yeah guys. 20 minus y. And then we multiply it by 5. But then since we don't know what y is, we have to put it in brackets. And that will equal the next term, which is 50. So we have 5 times 20, 100 minus 5y is equal to 50. Rearrange with beautiful algebra, y is equal to 10. Y is equal to 10. And find the first term. So now that we know that y is equal to 10, yeah, so we need to find what the next term is. So to find the next term, relax, it's similar to this, that's just your hint, but we don't have a general formula. Yeah, we know y is 10, but we know that to find the next term. So if we have this term, the first term, this is the first term. The first term, comma, then the second term, comma, third term. So for our first term, let's just call it x. So our first term, in order to get 20, we must subtract y from it and multiply it by 5. So we have x, then we subtract y from it. And if we multiply it by 5, and that's going to equal the next term, which is 20, and we even know what y is, we just calculated it. So y is minus 10. So if we multiply, we're gonna get 5x minus 50 is equal to 20. And with beautiful algebra, therefore, x will equal the first term, which is x, and is 14. Boom, we have just found it, guys. And because I even said this dot just means it continues. They said the second term, they even said the second term is 20. Yeah. Anyway, I hope you guys loved it. Freaking easy as, like, most of it was easy. Just, this was the hardest and best question. I love this paper. Damn. Anyway, yeah, but this was lovely. One more question here. Fuck you, Cambridge International Examination. You could have been more lenient, but hey, hope you liked this. Leave a like, subscribe if you want to, and just comment which paper you want me to solve, and comment that feedback. I like that feedback. Alright guys, later.